Hi, I'm Nicholeen Peck. I teach communications, parenting, and self-government all over the world. And in this video, we're going to be talking about how to support a child's social and emotional development. Ago, after speaking at a conference, another speaker, my friend Dan, pulled me aside and said, "Nicholeen, I love what you teach because it's all about helping children become emotionally strong." I'd never thought about it like that before, but I said, "That's true. That's exactly what I'm teaching. I don't want people to be held captive by their emotions. I want them to use those emotions for good and to be able to be strong emotionally. I want them to know what to do with their emotions and how to use them in good and productive ways." In this video, I'm going to share 4 tips for supporting a child's social and emotional development. Those 2 things are connected. Have you heard of the term emotional intelligence? I hope so. The term has been around for quite some time. In fact, emotional intelligence is thought by some to be some of the greatest intelligence that a person can have. It certainly influences society more than academic intelligence does. So, what does it mean to be emotionally intelligent? Well, when a person is emotionally intelligent, then they are able to analyze the emotions that are happening within themselves and choose when it's appropriate to use those emotions and when it's not. So, an emotionally intelligent person knows how to bond to people, share love and kindness and understanding, deep feeling, but they also know that sometimes it's not okay to share emotions. It's a bad moment, or it could maybe even be manipulative to dump their emotions out on another person. So there are some times where they hold back and they choose their thought processes instead of their emotional outbursts. So a person who's emotionally intelligent recognizes what the job of emotions are, which is to cue you to something, to be a sign that maybe some action needs to be taken, but they don't decide that the emotions should necessarily be dumped out upon another person, because that's not always the productive path. So a person who's truly emotionally intelligent thinks about their emotions before they use them. So what about social intelligence? Well, emotional intelligence leads to social intelligence, but there's also another kind of intelligence that's called practical intelligence. When a person has practical intelligence, they know how to problem solve, work with people, communicate well. They know what people want and they know how to deliver it to those people. People that have emotional intelligence and practical intelligence are usually some of the most influential people in the world. They make great leaders and people can't wait to learn their secrets. So if we are going to support our child socially and emotionally as they develop, then we need to teach them about their emotions. We need to help them become more emotionally intelligent and practically intelligent. And I do this by teaching my children how their brain works, how their emotions work, when they can choose to take actions or not. And I do this by teaching them something called self-government. So what is self-government? Self-government is the process of being able to determine the cause and effect of any given situation, and then possessing the knowledge of your own behaviors, feelings, thoughts, emotions, so that you can control them. Now, that doesn't mean that we never share a sad emotion or even a frustrated or angry emotion. It just means that we pick the right time to do it, the time that will help us most and that will help us be understood by other people. I'd like to share with you some key things that you can do as you're creating an environment where a person learns to be aware of their practical intelligence and their emotional intelligence as they're learning self-government. One key thing that every person and every child needs to learn about is calmness. And they need to learn that they can choose the calmness too. Does your child understand what calmness really is and what it's not? There's a key time when all of my children are little, usually around age maybe 2 or 3, when I teach them, this is a calm face, this is not a calm face, this is a calm voice, this is not a calm voice, this is a calm body, This is not a calm body. And so we help them differentiate between what is calm and what is not. This conversation carries on through all of their years of development so that they are able to recognize when they are being calm and when they're not, as well as when somebody else is being calm and not. Helps them read people emotionally and socially. After your children learn what calmness is, what it feels like, what it looks like, then they need to know the big truth that everyone can choose calmness. Nothing just happens to your emotions. You can choose to be calm and not cater to emotions. You can choose to think instead of emote on somebody else. They need to know that truth and practice not dumping out their emotions in certain circumstances and thinking and talking about things instead, so that they recognize their emotions have the power to tell them when action is needed, but it doesn't necessarily require dumping the emotions. That's not the action that's required. There's just some action that's needed. But it could be a discussion or maybe uses of a skill or understanding another person better, maybe even waiting before the action is taken. Before I get to my next tips, which I know you're going to enjoy, I just wanted you to know that I am discussing this topic today through the lens of self-government. So I teach self-government, and on my website, teachingselfgovernment.com, you can find podcasts, videos, blogs, and different products and courses that can be helpful to you as you learn the process of governing yourself and as you teach that to your children as well. So go to teachingselfgovernment.com for more help in that area. Now, let's move on to the next tip that I have for you today. If you want your child to develop properly when it comes to social and emotional control and connectivity to other people, they need to know that they can't take everything personally. Sometimes we feel things when people are talking and behaving around us, but we need to remember that just because somebody is expressing a feeling doesn't mean that we need to take it personally. That means we need to drop the subject sometimes. This also means that just because we have a feeling, we don't need to take it personally every time. So dropping the subject is a key skill to helping a person learn to develop healthy social and emotional skills. The next tip I have for you is to describe. When a person learns to describe instead of react when something has gone right or wrong, then that person learns to take a step back before they engage emotionally or socially with another person. This is good. If a person feels like they can plan their social and emotional engagements, then they're much more successful and confident as they're interacting with other people. So what do I mean by describe? Let's say something went wrong. When a person is expressing emotions about something going wrong, they might get angry, frustrated, cry, yell at another person maybe. But when a person learns how to describe, they won't do those reactions. Instead, what they do is they think to themselves, okay, I tried to do this thing, but it didn't work. That is one of life's no answers to me. So am I going to just say okay and accept that no? Or am I going to disagree appropriately with it and try it again? So those are some of the skills that we teach our children: disagreeing appropriately, accepting no answers. Some of these skills are part of the teaching self-government parenting system that I mentioned earlier. So when a person has these types of skills to reference when something goes wrong, then they don't have to react. They have something to describe because they have a set of skills that they can look at and compare their situation to. As a parent, I also have chosen not to react, but to describe instead. This helps my children understand how to solve problems in a calm and effective way. So when they do something they shouldn't do, instead of saying, "What were you thinking?" I look at them and I say, "Just now, I gave you an instruction, and you didn't look at me or keep a calm face, voice, and body, and so I know that you're not choosing to follow instructions. What you should have done was all 5 steps to following instructions, 2 of which are to look at the person and keep a calm face, voice, and body." Then I move on with my correction, tell them what they earned, and we practice doing things the right way. This type of teaching is a descriptive teaching. It feels very safe. It doesn't feel accusatory. In fact, everyone feels like it's actually a good, positive, and productive thing to be corrected. I always tell people that when you correct your children, you should actually feel closer to them than you did even before you had that moment of correction. And that is possible, especially if you have a describe mindset instead of a react mindset. When you describe, you can have relationships even in moments where corrections need to occur. But if you're reacting all the time, you end up with a reactionship instead. If you've enjoyed this video about supporting the social and emotional development of our children, I know you'll enjoy the next video too, which is how to understand, identify, and release your emotions. Click on that video now.